It's Wednesday, June 10th, 2009. This is the world's greatest podcast. Today we have a special guest with us, cheeseburger whiz Kevin Pang. I'm Mary Schmich of the Chicago Tribune. This is my column writing colleague, Eric Zorn. Okay, guys, what are we talking about today?
Well, first thing I want to do is I want to quiz you guys, Tribune employees. You know, we get the name world's greatest podcast. It's sort of a joke or a riff on the world's greatest newspaper. Which is the Tribune,
WGN,
which is where this radio station got its name. Can anyone tell me when the Tribune began using world's greatest newspaper and when it stopped? Any guesses?
I don't think it ever stopped, though. I mean, aren't we still the world's greatest newspaper?
In our little minds, we are, but we actually formally stopped putting it on the front page. Any guesses when?
1990s.
1976, wow. December 31st, 1976. And, if I'm remembering correctly.
And what happened on January 1st?
Well, it just disappeared, and they asked Clayton Kirkpatrick, who's the editor or the publisher then, I can't remember. So why did you stop doing that? Why did you say you're not the world's greatest newspaper anymore? He said something like, "Because we're not." That was pretty funny. Anyway, I just thought throw that in.
Moving on.
Let's move on to the next topic. A little quiz, and they started in 1911. So.
Moving on, Eric.
Move on. You're the host. Do you want
Patty Blagojevich reality show? You guys are going to have to fill me in because I have been on vacation. I've been in my own reality show lately, and all I know is that Patty Blagojevich has been eating bugs somewhere. Fill me in.
She has been. She's been eating bugs and telling people why her husband is innocent in sort of short 45-second chunks. And also a dig at Judy Bartopinka. I'm not sure if you saw that
I did see that. It was more than a dig. It was a big slap upside the head with a shovel.
But never using her name. I don't think she ever invoked the name.
But calling her like...
Wait, what's a reality show? I'm a celebrity. Get me out of here.
Yes, that's
how
the
does
show.
That show work?
It's on four nights a week on NBC. Or actually, 5 hours a week in because they were canceled last night for hockey or something, but it's on 5 hours a week. It's semi-live. I think they tape most of it during the day, and then they edit it and present it that night.
Basically, they put celebrities in uncomfortable situations, and they have the option of hitting the kill switch by saying, "I'm a celebrity, get me out of here," and they will stop from eating bugs and whatnot. And then at the end of the show, viewers can vote to see who stays, and I think this is all for charity, though, or something like this.
Some of it is.
Right,
so
they
that's
are
the
being,
rationale for doing it, right? So it's not just purely self-serving.
Well, it is
self-serving
because they are getting paid. I mean, there are some reports that each celebrity is getting paid, I think, like $120,000 per episode. So,
okay, for our other listeners who have been on vacation, fill me in on Patty Blagojevich. How long has she been there? How long will she be there? What has she done?
Well, she's been on there for, I think, 2 weeks or so. That's how long the show has been
on. At least a week and a half now, yeah. So I think it started a week ago Monday, and now we're finishing the second week. They're in the jungle of Costa Rica. They're living in a camp. It's unclear how isolated this camp actually is. There's a zillion cameras around and clearly medical personnel close by and so on. But
there's also a Hilton close by as well, I think.
Is there? And I don't know. One of the questions that I have, and you might have some insight into this, is are these people really living out there in the wild, you know, constantly? Or are they allowed to go back to the hotel and take a shower or have a decent meal or get a night's sleep?
Surely. Come on. Well, surely.
Well, there was a story in the paper today that called into question the veracity, the reality of reality shows, right?
That's interesting. It was in the live section in today's paper that talk about how these networks are now, these stunts that they have of I think the example that they used was of Heidi Montag and Spencer Pratt, who are these two kind of antagonistic young
repellents.
as Conan O'Brien called him, fist magnet in his face, and said that there's some news report. This was actually like on CNN.com saying that Heidi Montag got checked into a hospital because of I think her reason was for torture. That was the reason that was listed by the NBC spokesperson, and how this is like. You know, reality TV is already fake. You know, it's already overly produced. It's overly edited. And now it's one level deeper into fakeness, how all this is basically a ploy to drive ratings and to get people to, you know, like, will Spidey, which is, you know, the name that they've the coined for this couple. Will Spidey,
Spencer
will they
and Heidi, yeah.
Right, will they or will they not come back to the show? You know, because I think there's this thing where they walked off last week and saying, "Oh, we're done with the show," and then they came back and they left again. I mean, it's
they added another Baldwin brother. They have Stephen Baldwin there, and they added Daniel Baldwin to come in, who are all sort of hanging on to.
Is anybody else surprised that these shows have sustained their popularity? I understand. You know, when Survivor started, I mean, I thought it was goofy, but I understood the appeal. But it's so much of the same stuff now that I really can't believe that people are still interested.
It's not so much that people are interested in it. It's that this is what people are given. You know, if you're only being presented with reality shows, I mean, they are cheap to produce, okay? I mean, it's not like Law and Order where you have to pay stars, you know, $1 million per episode. It's not like Friends where by the end they were getting paid. Each one of the Friends was getting paid $1 million per episode, okay? This is cheap to produce, and so that's what you're given. That's what, you know, we ingest. You know, if I'm only being fed a steady diet of gummy bears, then, you know, I'm
but the ratings
have
are good, aren't they? I mean, but people actually like to watch these shows, right?
Well, I mean, I don't know if it's
well,
let
me speak for myself. I like to watch.
What do you watch? Last question, and then you're out.
Well,
No.
I have a follow-up question on this. I want to ask about the political benefits possibly to this, because Patty Blagojevich is doing, I think, acquitting herself very well. She looks like one of the few grown-ups in camp. She's sympathetic. She's kind of soft-spoken. She does go through these little crying jag the other day about how hard this is, as she has to drive a 21-year-old car. But
relatively speaking, though, I mean, relatively, like, she on this show, I mean, I'm sure the publicist for her is saying, like, just go on the show. You can appear, you know, motherly, and, you know, you'll gain America's sympathy. But to me, she is... It's relatively, like, I have as much sympathy for her as Lou Diamond Phillips, okay? So if...
Who's also on the show, Mary, by the way.
So, Lou Diamond, a little bit on the same level as Lou Diamond Phillips, and you know, Janice Dickinson is below her. So if John Sally's wife ran for political office, I would still vote for John Sally's spouse, okay? So it's all relatively... It's all
so
on
you're saying
scale.
That this is helping Patty and therefore helping Rod
yeah,
somehow?
Yeah, I mean, my theory, I mean, a little bit anyway. I think Patty Blagojevich is coming off, I think, very well. Another person who's coming off, I think, extremely well is Sanjaya, the guy from American Idol. He seems like a really charming presence.
He was charming on American Idol,
And Lou Diamond Phillips is also...
Okay, last deep
anyway,
thought
enough,
on this topic.
That's it. I think it's going to redound slightly well to the Blagojeviches, and they're going to have a lot of money from it. So I think it's a win for them.
Moving on
to vacations. Can we talk about vacations? Real vacations?
Yeah, well, you did your column today on vacations, 10 things to do.
On how to make your vacation last. I was just on vacation, which is why I don't know about the reality show updates.
Because you would ordinarily.
And, you know, one of the things, I mean, vacation is always so short.
Yeah.
You know, it's as short as a hiccup. By the time you go, you pack, you go, and then you're back. And you got a suitcase full of dirty clothes, and you feel like you didn't go anywhere. So I was just contemplating how you can make your vacation stretch. I started by bookmarking this cabin where I went, and every day I would check it several times a day. And so I was taking a little virtual vacation.
I wasn't clear how you say you're bookmarking it. Is there like a live camera there?
No, there's a website. There's a website for this place that I went.
And the cabin?
I would just look at, you know, I would look at cabin 15 every day.
So it's a little bit like senioritis. It's like the last few days of high school where your mind is already checked out toward the Disneyland vacation.
Right,
you're
right.
Mentally preparing yourself for that.
Right, right. So there are things to do on the front end of your vacation and the back end of your vacation to make the vacation last longer. On the front end, you really should wash your dishes before you go. You really should make your bed. You should close your drawers. Have you ever come back from vacation and just had all the drawers splayed open and the socks and the underwear flying everywhere and you're immediately depressed?
I just came back from Leelanau, Michigan, which is just a absolutely gorgeous place up in it's called the Little Finger of Michigan, if you can see it as a glove, and just beautiful lakes and natural sand dunes. Yes, it's where your pinky is, right here.
Leelanau, how do you spell this?
Leelanau. It's actually just northwest of Traverse City, which is itself a Nice cozy little town. But yeah, I came back. Oh, by the way, it's the asparagus and cherry capital of North America.
Now here's a question. Do you take your laptop with you? Do you take your BlackBerry with you? Do you Twitter when you're up there? Do you?
I did.
Of course. He's Kevin Pang. Kevin Pang without gadgets?
Well, I know. I was told by someone I was working with, she said, do not Twitter, do not bring your laptop, do not bring your BlackBerry and turn it off.
And then she had to rouse Kevin from his faint on the floor.
I just couldn't do it. And I don't know why, what compels me to, you know, I'm sitting here, I'm sitting at dinner and having this really fancy, you know, meal prepared. And I'm telling people what I'm eating. I'm like, oh, this grilled asparagus.
Why
is
are
just
you doing that, Kevin? Seriously, what's the impulse?
I don't know what the impulse is. Is it that people are being voyeur? Is it the voyeuristic? I don't know. I don't know what it is.
It's the opposite of voyeurism, though, right? It's when you're broadcasting what you're doing all the time.
Is it ego?
It's part of it's creating the Kevin Pang brand. Though,
well, it's
isn't
not.
It?
But you know what?
It's not.
Well, I mean, on Twitter, I mean, I sort of keep it. I keep my Twitter feed private. I mean, I don't want to broadcast because sometimes I write things that are not work related. So
Kevin the Pang, a Twitter.
Oh, great!
By the way.
Thank you.
It's no longer private. There you go.
But I don't know what compels me to just divulge every detail. Is it the fact that maybe perhaps I'm trying to present this version of myself that is like this sanitized version? I don't know.
I mean, what's interesting to me is that you seem to be ambivalent about doing it. I mean, you know, you do tweet a lot, and I would assume that anybody who tweets as much as you do or Eric does wants to be doing this, but you're expressing ambivalence about doing
it. I think part of it too is that I'm trying to document my life because it's interesting if I go back and
we
read
have journals
things
for that, you know.
Well, this is the new journal. It's 140 character journals, and I can do that. And instead of writing, 500 words at the end of the day, I can do it in just short burst of 140 characters throughout the day, and I can look because you know I don't remember what I did a week ago. I don't even remember what I did 2 days ago or yesterday or what I ate. But now it's kind of interesting to go back and seeing, oh, this was my mindset. This was what I was reading at that time.
Right, but we used to write that in journals and then hide our journals and hope no one found
but
our
journals. But you know
journals.
What? But what happens, though, and this happens online all the time, is that you get people who really, if nobody cared, if people were telling you, I don't care, stop this, or if people stop subscribing to you. But what happens is when you are tweeting like this in a moderate fashion, and there are people who tweet all the time, and Kevin's not one of them. I follow his feed. It's easy if I, and I'm interested. I have to say, I'm interested in what he's doing. He leads an interesting life. It's an interesting feed.
So are you going to tweet on your, you're going on vacation next week. Are you going to be tweeting, Eric?
I'll probably not so much. I might, but I'll definitely we'll see. We can all, I'm Eric Zorn at Twitter. So, it's something where, you know, you find that people are, they do engage with you. Like they do like that. I mean, and you get feedback at the oddest times, and people, it is a form of communication. It's a form of socializing.
And it's also a great form of distraction. I recently took Twitter and Facebook off my bookmarks where I have Cabin 15 bookmarked. I took Facebook and Twitter off. I can still get into them, and I do a couple times a day, but as long as they were on my bookmarks, I was just compulsively, reflexively going in every 15 minutes.
I can top you on that. I have TweetDeck. I have two screens running on my computer, and one screen is TweetDeck, which is constantly updating all these Twitter feeds. So it does take some time. But on the other hand, I will say this, that there's also a lot of people do put a lot of interesting things on there. It's not just, you know, what you're eating, but there's news stories people are seeing. I find a lot of interesting material on there.
There is interesting material, but we all need to take a break from it. And I know I'm compulsive enough about this stuff that Cabin 15 didn't have electricity. It had no cell phone reception. It had no internet. I mean, I just have to cut myself off, you know, like a junkie who can't bring dope into the house or booze into the house or cookies.
You're more disciplined than I. And the sad thing, one last point, is when I was booking hotels, I made sure that this place had Wi-Fi, and I sort of regret that.
Ambivalent Kevin Pang.
So I there's an issue that I wanted to talk about just really briefly, and that is with this University of Illinois admissions scandal that the Tribune's been reporting a lot about. The president of the university was on with John Williams yesterday, and he was on with Carol Marine the night before on Channel 11. And what he was saying was, he said this. He said, and I'll paraphrase this. He said, I didn't clout these people in. They were speaking of relatives of Resco, but I wrote an email saying the governor wants these people in. Please keep me informed about the process of it. And he said that was not pressure to him. And my broader take on this is that this is a boss who doesn't realize how everybody looks at the boss's words and tries to decode them. And so that, and bosses have to realize that whenever, if a boss says, you know, I like a cup of tea in the morning, that every morning his minions are going to bring him a cup of tea because everyone is trying to figure out what the boss wants. So if you get an email like this saying, please keep me informed of this, that's telling him something. I mean, so that even though he may not, in his heart of hearts, he may not have intended that he was sending that message to people.
Right.
Any thoughts
right.
about that?
Well, I mean, I think that's absolutely true. I just think people with power misunderstand the power that they have in all sorts of ways. And I think this is one of them.
Sure. Well, my question is, and this is this a hard school to get into? I mean, I'm not from the Midwest.
It is now, yeah. It's a very hard school to get into. And,
okay.
and they say it's the best value in American education, so...
So, you know, I thought you had a good column yesterday, Eric, you know, in which you were pointing out that clout operates in every aspect of our lives.
Mm.
It just does. It always will. In this case, you know, to ask that we know that it's operating, I think is legitimate. But the idea that we're going to remove clout from the decisions, you know, entirely from the decisions that are made at this university, at any university, in all the realms of society, it's quixotic. I mean, I think it's interesting. It's good to know that this is happening.
Well, I mean, on paper, it sounds bad. I mean, I'm just being complete devil's advocate here. But, I mean, what's wrong with, like, hey, call a buddy and seeing what you can do? Or am I just missing the point here?
No, you're not missing the point. That's how the world works, right? I mean, in a lot of ways, it works in industry, it works in the private sector in all respects. You know, it's what networking is all about, right? You get a recommendation, you get somebody who knows somebody, and that's, you know, it's not just that you're you know, the president of the Senate has clout. People far lower down have lesser degrees of clout, and they try to clout people in. And so when it's not pure merit, and that was what I moved on to in this column was, you know, it's... There's the legacy admissions at a lot of schools where they give you an extra leg up if your parents went there.
Well, that's clout.
Well, that's a form of clout.
Well,
it's a different...
and the idea that merit is a particular thing, that even grades signify a standardized thing. I mean, grades in one high school mean something very different from grades in another school. Some people have been extremely well trained in taking the SAT and others haven't. I was a college admissions officer in my previous life. And, you know, college admissions can and I think should be a subjective thing. The idea that all you would do is plug scores and numbers into the machinery and let the machinery figure out based on grades and scores who deserves to get into an institution is wrong. This is not to defend clout, okay?
Right.
But the idea that there is some kind of objective, purely standardized measure for college
merit,
admissions,
yeah.
You know, is wrong.
That must be an interesting job, actually.
Do you think that warrants, though, the president of the university stepping down?
No.
There's been calls for that.
No, I don't think so, because I don't think it's that extraordinary. I think they formalized it a little bit more than other universities might. But I think the way it's being handled right now with an investigation by the governor, that seems to me to be fine. I don't feel like these people were really...
Right. And, you know, we're living in a world, in our zero-tolerance world, where someone must always be fired or resign for every infraction, and I just think that's silly. I don't think that serves institutions particularly well to kill the top leadership every time something goes wrong.
Should we move on to our recommendations here?
Yes.
Kevin, go first.
Okay.
So this is our entertainment segment, Fun Things to Do.
Well, I'm reading a book right now I love sort of non-narrative, magazine-length journalism. And so this guy, David Samuels, who has written for the New York, the New Yorker and the Atlantic Monthly and Harper's, it's really one of my favorite types of journalism, which is literary takes on lowbrow subjects. Chuck Klosterman does this particularly well. And it's just a really interesting. It's a a collection of his essays called Only Love Can Break Your Heart. And he writes
Give
about,
us an example of one.
Well, he goes to, you know, Woodstock and just reports on not the manager, but the person who organized Woodstock had this grand envision of love and peace and you know, this music festival. This is Woodstock 99, and how it just ended up with women being, you know, raped and people dying and water costing $10 and people sleeping in raw sewage. It's really interesting take. So
wow.
It's easily digestible. They're like 20-30 pages.
Unlike the food
and the
Woodstock
title
99.
Again.
It's called Only Love Can Break Your Heart by David Samuels. It's a collection of his magazine.
I'll
pieces.
Put a link up. I'll put a link up to that on my blog, chicagotribune.com/Zorn. Well, I'll also put a link to Mary's recommendation, whatever it might be.
I just finished watching all 5 seasons of 6 Feet Under. I finished it last night. I was weeping. I have not wept like that in so long. This is just an amazing, amazing show. Have you seen it, either of you?
I've seen bits of it, yeah.
I highly recommend it. And I recommend doing it, you know, from season one all the way through. You just get so involved with these characters. It really is about life, death, love, lust, you know, all the big themes. Amusing, heartbreaking.
This is your binge TV.
Brilliantly thing. Acted, yes.
Speaking of really quickly, I'd be remiss if I did not mention of DVD box sets. My favorite TV show of all time. And is The Shield. I'm not sure if you've ever seen that, but it's on FX. Michael Chiklis is on there. Season 7, the DVD just came out yesterday. It's the final season. It is one of the great dramas of television.
It's history. Like a morally conflicted cop, yeah. Right? I mean, he's like, yeah.
I
saw the last 20 minutes of that, actually.
Eric.
I cheated. I have for those of you who don't have all the time to devote to 6 Feet Under, I have a blog posting that I thought was very interesting, and it was by a blogger named Kent Pittman. And he talks about, he says, a very useful 3-word phrase that they don't teach us in school and that we all need to learn. And he argues in favor of the phrase, I don't understand. Mm. And he talks about how this is a phrase, and I'm going to read a tiny bit of this here. He says, people distrust people who purport to understand everything. I think they are reassured by being around people with a confidence to identify what they don't understand. The phrase is therefore naturally collaborative. It invites helpful cooperation. He just talks about how saying, I don't know or I don't understand, people are afraid to say it. It's a great thing to say. And I have a link to the blog post, and I'll put that up there. I'm not going to be here next week for the podcast because I'm going on vacation.
Maybe Kevin will come back.
Maybe you can get Kevin to come
John
back.
John will be here. I'll be here.
It would be a pleasure.
And well, thanks for coming. Kevin's show, by the way, The Cheeseburger Show, is available where? It's
on cheeseburgershow.com and Thursdays. Well, it airs 6 times a week on CLTV. So
well, what doesn't on CLTV?
What doesn't?
Right?
But, okay. And we're out of here.
We're out. Thanks a lot.